We're in 1 Peter 5. You know, there's not too many more verses to go through, but there's some important ones to go through, and I want to go through them. So someone read 1 Peter 5, 1 through, let's go through 7 this morning. 1 Peter 5, 1 through 7. Anyone? Before I call on Vanessa. Go ahead, Vanessa.
Therefore, I exhort the elders among you as your fellow elder and witness of the sufferings of Christ and a partaker also of the glory that is to be revealed. Shepherd the flock of God among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but voluntarily, according to the will of God, and not for sordid gain, but with eagerness. Nor yet as lording it over those allotted to your charge, but proving to be examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. You younger men, likewise, be subject to your elders, and all of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, for God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Yes. Some powerful scripture here. And I'm not going to go over thoroughly what we talked about, summarize like I usually do last week, because we talked on leadership and what leadership is supposed to do. And I'm afraid some of you may require the leadership to do what we talked about. But I will say that you can require husbands and head of their homes to be able to do the same things. Remember, We said that again, as we've said many times, the family is the first church, and but just three things. One, whether you're an elder, whether you're an officer, whether you're a father, husband, we're to do three things. One is to feed the flock, feed the family. What does that mean? What does it mean to feed the flock? We talked about this last week. What was that?
To feed them the word.
Yeah, give them just stuff it down their throats. Just cram it down. it's really to really feed, to provide for them spiritually. The second thing was to oversee them with vigilance and sincerity. And lastly was to be examples. We represent God to our family. Men, head of your homes, you represent God to your family. And if you're, God gives a special dispensation of grace to those who do not have that person in their homes, but through the church, but we're supposed to be fed, and the leadership are supposed to be doing these things. So let's go on here, because there's some important scriptures here this morning I want us to go over. And so Peter has explained the responsibilities of the elders of the church, and then he continues to give instructions to the flock. Who is the flock? Yes, us, all of us. So I believe, what was that? All right, so I believe really the next few verses are some of the most important and most impactful and life-changing verses in all of Scripture. And so I don't want us to miss them. Peter is especially addressing here, right after he talks about leadership, the younger men. And in this case, he is not referring just to age. You need to know that. Younger is the same word Jesus uses in Luke 22:26, and he says these words. He says, "But it's not this way with you, but the one who is greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like the servant." So the younger he's talking about here is to be subservient, to be a subordinate to God's authority. Understand? Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
So it's not just talking about, again, the scripture here is it can be generic. He's talking about younger men, but it's also meaning younger women as well. Any of us younger in the Lord, or younger in the sense that if we don't hold an office, we are to be subservient to those who do. Subservient is not that they're not to lord it over you. Everybody, we talked about that last week. Remember, they're not to, you know, not to be prideful, but we are to honor them. So Peter exhorts those who are not in office, hold an office in the church, to submit themselves to the elders. Wow, it's just the kind of word that does that make you a little nervous? I mean, when you see some of the leaders, does that make you just a little nervous about those who are in charge of the church? That you ought to submit yourselves to them, their oversight? Well, yeah, it should. It should. But we're supposed to yield to their authority out of respect to do what the Word of God implies. Hebrews 3:17, the author of Hebrews, Apollos, says these words. I'm kidding. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they keep watch over your souls as those who will give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with grief, for this would be unprofitable for you. This almost sounds like, the same thing that Paul is saying in Ephesians when he's talking about children obeying your parents. Children, obey your parents in the Lord so that it will be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. That just sounds like a great promise, doesn't it? And all you have to do is what? Obey your parents. Submit to your leadership. Oh, that the church would be in this place. Oh, that the church would want to be in this place. That those that are not in that position that God has called them to be, to oversee, that they would be willing to submit. Oh, where has it gone? Or has it ever really been? And then next, the apostle says to clothe yourself. Now he's speaking to the younger men, but anyway, he's speaking to the younger, to the flock. Clothe yourself. Now, I want you to get this picture. As a Christian, you want to look good, okay? You want to look good to people, right? So you go to your closet, and you want to look your best. You want to put on what's best in this closet, and so you have to present yourself to everyone. Everyone sees who you are, and your first impressions are usually good. So you want to dress rightly, and so you must pick out the right garments to be impressive, right? So that's what you're doing. You know, you're going to this closet. You're supposed to clothe ourselves. And Paul says that we're supposed to clothe ourselves with what? Well, what are the garments he says to put on? He says to put on what? The armor of God. Put on the armor of God. And they say you have to dress up. We have to dress up every day in order to stand against the schemes of who? You have to dress up in order to stand against the schemes of the devil. So you have to put on the armor of God. So what do we put on? Who could say these things? Who remembers? Salvation. All right, yeah. Let's just start. We gird ourselves with what? Gird our loins with? With truth. With truth, all right. We put on the breastplate of righteousness. Very good. We shod our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Good. We take up the shield of faith. Very good. Then you put on the helmet of salvation. And then you also take on the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And then, I mean, it's something we've all heard a lot of sermons about these things. It's great. So to defeat the enemy, Paul says to block the schemes of the enemy, we need truth, we need righteousness, we need peace, we need faith. We need salvation, and we need the Word of God. That's all you need. It's quite a bit, isn't it? That's quite a good. Now, that's to defeat the enemy. This is what we need to go. If we're going to defeat the enemy, we're going to break the schemes of the devil. We're going to go into our closet, and we're going to put on these things. Okay. but to get along with each other. To get along with you and I. Hear me. To get along with each other, we need another unique and special part of our wardrobe. We may have to look for the most elegant article, garment in our closet. And what is it? We're to clothe ourselves with what? Humility. Humility. Wow. To be able to live with each other, we're going to have to wear what? Let me say that again. One more time. What is your definition of humility? Teachable? Lay down your rights. Putting your others before yourself. See yourself as God sees you. Well. Totally dependent on the Lord. It's funny, I was sharing with Tim and Casey about humility. Just, and Tim said, I'd like to know the definition. I said, well, I wrote that down this morning. I was going to ask everybody, what's your definition of humility? And Casey reminded me of Kathy had given me a book, Andrew Murray, on humility. And I've been reading that. What's his definition of humility?
Thank you. Someone can correct me. I think he said it's not thinking of yourself less. Or it's not thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less.
Yes. Say it one more time.
Humility is not thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less.
Wow. Wow. Isn't it amazing? I mean, I just... and hear me, if anybody here calls yourself a millennial, that word is just absolutely non-existent in the teaching or in the training of our lives. What'd you say? Turn on the TV and what?
Do the opposite of what you see.
That's humility. Because everything you're being told, everything that's being presented to you is what? It's all about me.com. Everything is focused on ourselves. Now I looked this up and I'm gonna the word in here to be clothed occurs nowhere else in the New Testament. Nowhere else in the New Testament. And it refers to a garment fastened by strings, strings through a loop. In other words, it's the same as taking a garment and putting a belt through it, so that you can keep your pants from falling down. That's what it means. From being embarrassed. That's what the word humility is signifying here. Something to hold up, hold on, hold together that which you're wearing. It holds you together. It keeps you from stumbling over yourself. I mean, this particular garment being described here refers to a long white outer garment that was commonly worn by slaves. The implication here is Peter is exhorting any believer to be willing to take up any task or position and to perform it, no matter how humble it appears, in order to serve and benefit others. It's the exact opposite. It's counterintuitive to what I hear in Christianity today. It's not looking for the most dignified office. And he's already said, if God puts you in that place, you're not to lord that over everyone. that you're something special. Do you know it's recorded that early Christians actually sold themselves to be slaves in order to be able to preach the gospel to those that were in bondage, to other slaves? Hey, let's start that ministry. Let's do that. How many people do you think you would come Sunday morning knowing you're going to give your life up and not have anything that you have anymore? Certainly the offerings would go down. Humility was to be put on as a garment bound to a person as a slave is to his master. Paul wrote in Colossians 3:13, he says, bearing with one another and forgiving each other. Wearing humility then allows obedience to be easier and causes obedience to make sense to us. Without humility, obedience doesn't make a lot of sense. It's just a law. But if you wear it, if you wear in humility, obedience makes life easier for you. But disobedience and pride, God is opposed to, Peter says. See, grace in our lives enters through humility, a life of humility. But God crushes the proud. I think it's such important. I can't begin to tell you how important this is in our walk. I can't even begin to tell you, as Bob Mumford said, screw your head off, pour it in there, and screw it back on, just so you can grasp a hold of what this means. That it would just become a part of our nature of walking day by day. Humility is the preserver of peace, not only in the church, but in the family. In the whole context of family, I would say humility is the guardian of peace in all of society. Adversely, pride is the disturber of tranquility. I believe pride is the cause of much of the dissension and the breaches within the church, within family life. God opposes the proud. He opposes them. You know what that means? It's God Almighty. If He opposes you, do you know what that means? Those that are proud war against God. He resists them because they are like the devil, enemies to God and to His kingdom, and to His kingdom on the earth. Solomon declares these words, that God scoffs at the scoffers, yet He gives grace to the afflicted. God gives grace to the humble. Amen. God gives grace to the humble. This means He gives more wisdom, He gives more faith, He gives more holiness, and even more humility to those who in meekness of character conduct their lives for Him. Listen, if His judgment begins in the household of God, 1 Peter 4:17, we talked about this a couple weeks ago. If His judgment begins in the household of God, what is He going to judge? How great we are? Or how humble we are. Gosh, it ought to hit home somewhere along the line. Paul says these words, "Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interest, but also for the interest of others. Have this attitude in yourself, which is also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every other name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father."
Amen.
What is he saying? Solomon said these words, "Pride goeth before the fall. Pride goeth before the destruction, and a haughty spirit before stumbling. It is better to be humble in spirit with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the proud." So out of all the clothes in our wardrobe, why humility? Why humility? Of all the things that we're supposed to put on, why clothe ourselves with humility? 3 points. One, that's what Jesus was. He was humble. He emptied himself and became man. He humbled himself and became to a as we just read, and became obedient unto death. You see, humility helps us obey. It makes it easier. We have an understanding of why. He is the root from which we grow. And if we are to bear any good fruit, we are to draw our source from the root of Jesse. Remember, every knee will bow to Jesus. Get this picture. You're bowing to humility.
Amen.
It doesn't make sense to us. How do you bow to greatness, don't you? You remember the story in Africa when I told you with the the elders came and they bowed before me, and I just got down on my knees and looked at them. I said, no, don't do this. I know it was dishonoring because they were trying to honor me. Not in that case. No, get up. Come on, it's Jesus we got to honor. Bow to humility. Number two, God is omnipotent. He's all powerful. He's all majestic. He's all knowing. He's all present. He's all masterful. So when we stand beside him, what are we? There you go. We're all nothing. All nothing except for the worth he gives us. Our humility as we stand alongside our sovereign is not just a disposition or a piece of clothing. It is a fact. We are but humble creatures. It's a fact. Whether or not we realize it is the $64,000 question. Number three, humbling ourselves before God is the next step in deliverance. Humbling ourselves sets us free. and then we are exalted. Then and then only can we be exalted. We are set free when we understand exactly who we are rather than what we would rather be. Our worth comes solely from a relationship to Jesus Christ and understanding how far we fall short of perfection sets us free from any false perception of our own greatness. When humility becomes the garment we wear, we are on the road to understanding patience when we are chastised. When humility is the garment we wear, we comprehend that submission actually brings God pleasure. When humility is the garment we decide to put on, we understand that repentance is a gift and hope in His mercy is comprehended. The command in verse 6 that we just read, or that Vanessa read, is to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God that He may exalt you at the proper time. I mean, sounds like James. Do you remember? We went through James, and it's the same words that James is using. Listen to James. James 4, 7 through 10. Submit, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be miserable and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the presence of God, and he will exalt you. That was James. I mean, would Peter copy James? Do you think Peter understood what hard circumstances these believers were living under? Of course he did. Do you think he knew the choices he was requiring of them and how they may struggle with his instructions? Yes. Do you think he too walked through the turmoil of denial and yet saw the victory through his own humility? He had something to say. He understood something. He understood where humility can take you. Out of this quagmire of trying to figure everything out, but into a victorious life of letting God rule and reign, deciding what we're to do and what we're to say and where we're to go. Peter did this knowing all too well that he too may be crucified for his beliefs. Which, according to tradition, happened. Except he got crucified upside down, is that right? So what advice does Peter go on to give the believers to the flock? Verse 7, cast all your anxiety upon him. Cast all your cares upon him. Throw your cares. Throw them onto him. Take off those garments. Those aren't the ones you're supposed to be wearing. Throw them at the feet of Jesus. The ones that are cutting, those cares that cut deep and are distracting, which wounds your souls and that pierces your hearts, and trust in Him. Listen, church. This is the instruction. This is the impacting, life-changing, to take all the concerns and worries of our life and give them to Him. This is life changing. What are you afraid of? What are you anxious about? What are you worrying about? And give it to Him. I mean, I can speak this one, and I'm telling you, you're going to head down the driveway, and you're just going to come right back. You're just going to put those garments right back on. But there's nothing to tie them on to you. These things do not remain. You will be only embarrassed. Those garments will fall off, and they'll rot. You see, by casting our cares on Him, He is willing to release you of your care and take the care of you upon Himself. Do I need to say that again? He releases you of your cares and takes the care of you upon Himself. He cares for you. He will care for you. He will take care of you. Take care of you. He will either avert what you're afraid of or love you through it. He will order all the events of your life so as to convince you of the Father's love and tenderness towards you in such a way that no hurt but only good shall come your way. Do you believe that? Come on. Do you believe that? You see, it's hard to believe that unless you're humble. Unless humility is clothed around you. It's not hard to believe when you're humble and you know who you really are and what you really can do and what you can't do. All of us have these cares. And many times are apt to labor under their burden. All of us have them. They're personal. Their health cares, their family cares, their cares of the present, their cares of the future, their cares for others, their cares for the lost, their cares for the church, their cares for this nation. But at times, these cares can be sinful, especially when they arise from unbelief. When they begin to even control and torture your mind, that's when cares become the burden that we cannot carry. They just weigh us down. These cares take on a criminality, I believe. These cares are criminal because they rob us. They rob us from serving the Lord with all of our hearts. All of our soul, all of our mind, all of our strength, don't they? Amen. These cares, they rob us. They're criminals. Do you see why He wants you to cast them off of you? This is the remedy. Cast all your cares on the Lord. Amen. Glory. Resign yourself to the wise and all gracious Lord of hosts. Even when those who loved and cared for Paul tried to persuade him not to go with his plans. This is in Acts 21. They said Paul's response to them. They were trying to keep him from going forth. And Paul said, "What are you doing weeping and breaking my heart? Why are you doing this? For I am ready not only to be bound, but even to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus Christ." And the next verse is almost written again as an afterthought. It says, "And since he would not be persuaded, we fell silent, remarking, 'The will of the Lord be done.'"
Hallelujah.
I imagine it's what Paul said. Hallelujah, finally. I've told this in the past. I told when Susan and I had to leave our hometown, and we had a prayer group, and we'd been meeting for years, and it was in those early days of Charismania, and we learned everything, or a lot of things, not everything, but a lot of things during those times. But when we left, they were sad. And so after we left, things were not going well at all. And I remember us going back home and getting with these folks again, and they said, "We've been praying that you'd come back. We've been praying that you wouldn't." I said, "Stop it! You're making us miserable. Stop it." One of the young men said, "It's going to be hard, but the will of the Lord be done. Cast all your cares." You go out there. There are those who know the calling of God, and they've got to cast all their cares upon the Lord. He will take care of them. But we cannot do it because in our own strength, we have to be clothed in what? Humility. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord gives grace and glory. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Glory. O Lord of hosts, how blessed is the man who trusts in you. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. Amen. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. And these whom he predestined, he also called. And these whom he called, he also justified. And these whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Come on. Come on. If God is for us, who can be against us? The key is humility. To understanding our life and our walk in the Lord Jesus Christ. We are nothing outside of him. But with him, we are conquerors, rulers, royal priesthood. Without him, are we to put on our own crown? As leaders, he already said, because if we will oversee the flock in the way it should be overseen, then we will get the unfading crown of glory. We listened to Stephen Burke the other night talk about the crowns. This woman had a vision of crowns and these different sizes of crowns, and all these things are available, and how beautiful and majestic they were. But that seems kind of odd, doesn't it? I'm doing this so I can get my crown. That crown is made out of the things and the lessons that we've had to learn and the things we've had to walk through in our trust in the Lord. And every time we come into it and we break through into a victorious place of depending on God, there goes another jewel added to it. But when we look for that and we try, here's I like this one, and put it on there, the weight is too heavy for us to carry. As a matter of fact, we fall underneath it. God, help us understand your humility, that all things work together for good. All things. Those who are called according to his purpose. His purpose, not ours. Several weeks ago, a word came to us here. And I want to ask Susan to come up and share that word one more time. Let's hear these words and let's leave on these words, okay? How humbling it is to know that so great a God can speak this kind of word to us.
The word of the Lord is saying, I am doing a new thing. What I have done in the past was good, but now it is time to move into deeper realms that you have read about, heard about, preached to about, but have had little movement in. I am speaking especially to the body of Christ that, as you would say, it is time to get on the same page in your request to me and in your request with each other. I am calling you out of a place, a separation unto yourselves, into a unity with each other and with me that you have yet to experience. This is where I will move. This is where I will move in answering your prayers. This calling is not for the lazy in heart. This calling is for those who yearn to see me move in realms not experienced before. Do not look back at me in the ways I moved before. Rather, grasp a hold of this word. Eat it as an appetizer, an entree, and as a dessert. In time, it will be wonderfully pleasing to your spiritual palate. Exercise body ministry. Exercise body prayer. Exercise sharing in one another's sufferings. This is the way of Christ. This is the way of Jesus. This is the prelude to be exercised, not only for the difficult days ahead, but also for my coming. You will find peace and rest for your souls.
Now stand up. Stand up just for a moment. Find yourself next to someone. I say that because right here you get next to my wife. In humility, turn to the person next to you. Make sure you, I don't know if we have an even crowd or not, but turn to the person next to you. And if it's three of you, that's okay. You three over there can be together. And just say, if God is for you, who can be against you? And let him answer the question. Answer the question. If God is for you, who can be against you? Give a definitive answer to that. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you have a purpose and plan for all of our lives, Lord. And you're saying for us to be able to get along with each other, we're going to have to put on humility. And the humility is to determine this, that if God is for you, who can be against you? It takes a humble heart to receive that, and a humble heart to answer it. But God is faithful. Amen? Amen. 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 Have a wonderful week. Go in humble surroundings. All right? Amen.